The thalamus is a small walnut-sized structure in the deep part of the brain that gets its blood supply from small perforating arteries that branch off of larger arteries. Now, because these arteries are small is one of the reasons why you're more susceptible to developing a blood clot in this area. The most common cause of a blood clot in this area is long-standing high blood pressure, just that pounding over time on these little tiny arteries damages the walls of the blood vessels, and then atherosclerosis, which is plaque buildup in the arteries. A portion of that plaque breaks off, ends up in one of these small arteries, again causing a blood clot, cutting off blood flow, creating damage to this area of the brain. So why do I tell you all this? Because that is the topic of today's video. Today we're gonna go over a thalamic stroke. If you're new to this channel, I'm Tara. I'm a neurologic physical therapist, and on this channel we talk about anything and everything related to mobility, health, fitness, mindset in the context of neurologic injury, with the end goal of empowering you with as many tools as possible to reach your highest maximum level. And all that being said, today's video is going to be a little bit different. I'm going to kind of go through a case study of a patient that I'm working with currently that has suffered a stroke in this area of his brain. I'm going to go through a little bit of some of the movement problems he's dealing with right now. I'm going to give you a little bit of history on his movement related symptoms, and then based on his goals, some of the things that we've been working on, some of the things that have worked, some of the things that haven't worked, some of the things that we've had to modify to help him to continually improve his mobility and improve his overall quality of life. So before I get into his symptoms, just a little bit more information about the thalamus. The thalamus is kind of like a main processing center in the brain. It has to take in a lot of information from different parts of the brain. It gets a lot of information from the body and kind of puts it all together in a neat package to perform a specific function. Now, these functions can include movement related functions. It also gets a lot of sensory information from the body, such as light, touch, pain, and temperature. So why do I tell you all this? Because again, we're gonna go into one specific case of a patient that I'm working with right now, but it's important to understand that there are a ton of different combinations of symptoms that you can end up with if you've had a thalamic stroke or you've had damage to this area of your brain. But back to this case in particular, this is a gentleman that, yes, he did have a stroke in his thalamus. Some of the main, I would say, strengths or things that we've been able to capitalize on that are positives if you have had damage to this area of your brain is he hasn't had damage to a true movement area of his brain. So he does have movement in his arm and his leg. We use a 5-point scale to measure strength in therapy, 5 being full strength, 0 being no strength at all. And he has probably about a 3/5 strength in the arm, grossly, and probably a 4/5 strength in his knee and his hip movement. So those are huge positives or huge benefits. Now, some of the movement problems that he is having in the leg is he can't lift his foot up. He has strength, so he can lift it up a little bit. He just can't lift it up a lot. So that ankle dorsiflexion, he's a little bit limited in that. And he does have an ankle foot orthosis for that, that is articulated. And I am gonna get into a little bit more of the specifics of that and how I've had to collaborate with his orthotist to kind of get the most or get the best walking pattern. So I'll get into that a little bit more further down on in this video. And then also he does have some abnormal extensor synergy in his leg, meaning that when his knee extends, his foot wants to point all at the same time, which is having an impact on his walking, which I'll get into more when I talk about like his gait deviations that we've been addressing. And then as far as the arm, he has movement in his shoulder blade, so he can move that flat bone on the back, which is really important because in order to reach, and I've talked about this in a lot of videos, there's a rhythm that needs to happen. That shoulder blade, that flat bone on the back of your shoulder needs to move in rhythm with your arm in order to get full voluntary arm movement overhead. So he has it, it's just weak. And then also just the arm reaching is weak, but he can do it. Extending the elbow, he can do that, so he can straighten his arm out, but he does have some abnormal synergy, so linking up, so his arm likes to rotate inward when he extends it, and so we've been addressing that. So when he goes to extend his elbow, his whole arm rotates inward. And then he does have difficulty supinating his hand, so turning his hand palm up and extending his wrist. However, he can do it. He can pick something up with that hand, move it, and set it down somewhere else, which is a huge bonus that we have been able to take advantage of as far as developing his home exercise routine. His balance is adequate, but definitely is not normal, so we've definitely been working on that. He can't single leg stand on his involved leg, and it's important to kind of drill that down or kind of get to the root cause of that, because that's different depending on the stroke. In his case, I think it's more of a sensory issue, because that thalamus is a processing center. It gets a lot of information from the body. I think it's more that his brain isn't getting good information about where that leg is. So I think that's why he can't maintain single leg standing on that leg. The leg just buckles out of nowhere. He'll be standing on it and then all of a sudden it just buckles. So we've been working on that. So he can't really single leg stand. He can't really tandem stand. So he can't maintain a position with his feet in a straight line. And he has difficulty standing with his feet really close together. Those two positions, feet close together and in a straight line, it really requires you to get a lot of information from both legs in order to maintain your balance or in order to adjust your position if you do get off balance. And then also, if he's standing with his feet close together and I have him do any kind of head movement, that really disrupts his balance as well. And so he does usually lose his balance or needs to hold on to something if he's gonna turn his head. So that's gonna be important when we get to some of the walking activities. So definitely something that is important to pick up on when you're trying to figure out what the underlying causes are that are making you feel not confident in certain situations when you are walking out in the community. So something that I made a note of and that we will address in therapy or in the exercises that we do in therapy and that he does at home. And then one thing that is unique to him and something I've never really seen before, and it is kind of a barrier to establishing some of the exercise routine, is he has no sensation. So he cannot feel touch. So if I touched him anywhere on the leg or the arm, he cannot feel that at all, which is very rare that someone has zero sensation. I don't think I've ever had anyone before that's had zero sensation. So that's been a little bit of a barrier, because obviously if you can't feel touch, that is a safety concern, but also it just makes, you know, learning new movement extremely challenging. So that is something that we've made a note of, and just means that when he's doing an activity, he actually has to be looking at that arm to make sure his brain kind of understands what he's learning. Now, as far as his gait pattern or the gait pattern issues or deviations that we've been working on in therapy, is he catches his toe probably about every 2 out of every 10 steps. So that's extremely problematic, because that's a fall risk. If you're catching your foot and you're walking forward, you have that forward momentum going. That's usually why someone might lose their balance forward. The pluses or the bonuses, he's got really fast reaction times when it does happen. So that's been a positive. The other things that we're working on is when he stands on the leg, remember that abnormal linking or synergy of the knee straightening out and the foot pointing at the same time. When he's standing on the leg, that happens, meaning his knee goes into hyperextension. A, that throws him backwards, so it does throw you off balance, but B, also it makes it hard for him to bend the knee in order to bring the foot forward. If he's not bending the knee at the right time when he brings the leg forward, then again, knee's not bending, that leg is also gonna be more prone to catch on the ground. The other thing he does, he spends a lot of time on his uninvolved leg. So if I compare the amount of time on his involved leg when he's walking versus his uninvolved leg, he probably spends double the amount of time on his uninvolved leg that he does on his involved leg. Now, that's not necessarily a huge problem, except for the fact that he is having pain in his opposite hip, his uninvolved hip. So we don't want that to get worse. So that's why that kind of moves that gait deviation up to the top of the priority list to work on the symmetry of his stance time or standing time. We want equal standing time on both legs so that that pain in the strong leg doesn't get worse. So now, what did we do about all this? Hopefully you have a good picture in your mind now of what he looks like. Hopefully those of you that have a thalamic stroke or have had a thalamic stroke or have a lesion in your thalamus, you might be able to relate to a little bit of what I just talked about, because he does have a lot of very typical symptoms to someone who's had a stroke in the thalamus. But as far as the arm goes, I really wanted to start with getting that shoulder blade moving. Remember that rhythm I told you about? He can lift the arm, but because he doesn't have that shoulder blade movement, he doesn't have that good rhythm that we want, and that really he's getting to a point where he's gonna get the arm as high as he can get it, and he's probably not gonna be able to get it much higher if we don't address that shoulder blade movement. So that's what we've been doing in therapy, is really isolating retraction and upward rotation of the shoulder blade with the arm overhead, because that's the position that the arm is going to be in when we want that shoulder blade moving into that upward rotation. So that's what we've been working on. I have shown exercises for that in a shoulder series that I've done, and I'll put a link for that video in the description below. But pretty much everything I did in that video, we are working on right now as far as the shoulder blade movement. And then also as far as the arm, we're trying to isolate elbow extension or straightening the arm out without it rotating inward. So we want to break up that pattern. We also want to isolate external rotation, because most of his movements are dominated by like an internal rotation at the shoulder. So we're trying to isolate external rotation. And then the wrist and the hand is great. He has the movement, it's just not strong. So we're really working on wrist extension with supination. So with flipping it over. His tendency is to ball up and what we call pronate or rotate it down. So we're trying to strengthen the opposite of that motion. And then also a lot of weight bearing. Weight bearing on the arm gets a lot of sensory input into the brain, but what it also does is it really encourages those elbow extensors. So if we put a little bit of weight on that arm, he has to straighten that arm out to support his upper body, and he can't rotate it inward because the hand is fixed on a non-moving surface. So we've been doing a lot of that, and also weight bearing with the arms behind him. That kind of sets the scapula up, or sets the shoulder blade up into a more retracted position versus a protracted position. So we've been doing a little bit of that, and he's doing a ton of work on his own at home. Some of the things that he's doing at home, again, because I think this is predominantly an awareness issue with that arm, he just doesn't always know where that arm is we're working on, he's eating all of his meals now with that arm, with his weak arm. Do you know how much discipline that takes? And he's doing it. And I think that's the number one reason why week after week, we continue to see improvements in his arm strength. And then also we're trying to address finding different ways that he can position himself and still do his work during the day. He likes to work at his computer a lot, but the arm has a tendency to either stay in his lap or sometimes it falls off the side of his chair. So we want to get that arm kind of in sight so that he can use it. When it's kind of out of sight, out of mind, he's less likely to use it or incorporate it into activities. And according to him, he spends hours on the computer a day. So that's hours where he's just has no awareness of that arm. So we've been working on that as far as the home exercise component, finding a better setup. We haven't come up with one yet where that arm will be in sight, but not interfere with his work. So right now we haven't found a formula that works where the arm is up on the desk and it doesn't interfere with his workflow. So we're still trying to figure that out. Now, as far as the walking, we're doing a ton of single leg standing on that leg, trying to increase the amount of time on that leg. And then I have conversations with him. I try and distract him a little bit so that he has to be more aware, or that leg, that sensory information has to be more like on point, so that it doesn't buckle. So of course we started with no distractions, but he's getting past that a little bit. He can go 5 to 7 seconds standing on that leg with the other foot on a block without that leg buckling. So we've been continuing to work on that. He's been working on that at home, and it's getting a lot better. The other thing that we've been working on in therapy is step ups. The step ups will also help to increase his awareness of that leg. And he's doing really good with that. He can step up with that leg onto, I think even like we did last week, like a 6-inch step. So that's really, really good. And then just stepping over different obstacles, different surfaces, foam, stepping on foam, stepping off foam, because remember, he's not getting good sensory information. The reason the rationale behind throwing someone into these activities of getting different surfaces under the feet, especially with the thalamus, is we can't bring those nerves in the thalamus back that have died. But what our brains are extremely good at is adapting. So if I keep putting him in these situations where his brain kind of has to think on the spot, it's going to develop a new kind of way of operating to make sure that his brain is getting as much information as quickly as possible so that he can formulate a good response or execute the movement in the midst of the surface changing or someone bumping into him. So we just keep challenging him. Again, we're not going to bring those neurons back, but you want to always challenge yourself in a safe way. And our brains are excellent at adapting. So it just gives the brain an opportunity to adapt. So we've been working a lot on that, and it is improving week after week. Now, as far as the AFO, we did have to make some adjustments with that, and that's where the orthotist and I really, really spent a lot of time together. It's a critical component of stroke rehab, is that team members are communicating with each other. So the brace isn't doing enough to keep that knee from going into hyperextension, and he's still catching that foot. And when he doesn't think about it, he just has a tendency to spend less time on that leg or swing that leg around the side. So the orthotist and I together came up with a solution based on some of her input. She added this strap to the brace, which is really cool, that kind of pulls the foot into a little bit more dorsiflexion to help stop that knee. It kind of pitches his body forward and stops his knee from hyperextending. The problem is that he started to have pain, and he hasn't ever had pain from the brace before. So it worked. He came back with the modifications on the brace, more dorsiflexion, and he was doing great. No foot catching at all. The knee was unlocking for him to bend it through the swing phase. Everything was going great. But because of that pain, we had to kind of start over. His orthotist is going to make him a new brace. She didn't make the original brace, so we think that just starting back at kind of ground zero and just starting from scratch, that maybe we can come up with a brace that's comfortable. The key components I still think for him are going to be that we really want that, what we call plantar flexion stop in that brace. And of course, we really want the brace to be articulated so that the ankle component bends. So that's where we're at with the brace, and we're working on that. But the modifications we made before were working excellent. So hopefully a new brace will address the issues that he's having, the pain that he's having in the ankle. And then that is it. That's kind of where we're at right now. Again, the huge strengths of his, or the huge things that we've been able to capitalize on him, because the stroke is in his thalamus and not really a movement related area of the brain, is that he has the ability to move all joints in his arm and his leg, which is great. He can move his hip, knee, and ankle. They're just not super strong, which is great. And he has an excellent support system, which has been a huge help. It's like he has a therapist with him all the time. So those are the things that we've really been able to capitalize on, and he is making improvement week after week. So we hope that that will continue. His big goals are to walk without an assistive device and eventually walk without the brace. So those are our big picture goals that we're keeping in mind. And then each week we just keep advancing, and it's going really, really well. And hopefully I'll be able to update you with even more progress on him in the future. If you like this video, it's a little bit different, definitely give it a thumbs up, and put in the comments hashtag case study if you want me to do more of these, just kind of breaking down my thought process. If you like them, I definitely have a good mix of patients right now that have a variety of kind of different symptoms, so I'd be happy to do more of these. If you're new to this channel and you haven't yet subscribed, definitely hit that subscribe button, turn on that notification bell so that you'll get notified every time I upload new videos. As usual, I'm going to remind you of our monthly lives. They're the last Wednesday of every month. You can sign up for those for only $5. You can submit questions in advance, and I will answer questions specific to your exact movement problems during that live session. So it's definitely worth it. It's only $5, plus you'll get to hear some of the issues that other people are having and hear my answers to them as well. So I think it's hugely valuable. And then also, if you're kind of done with therapy, you're just kind of going off the handouts that they gave you in therapy, I just want to remind you, we do have an exercise vault on our website. It's part of a monthly membership. It's $30 a month, and it's basically progressions of exercises just to give you more ideas on how to advance your current home exercise program. Again, if you're done with therapy or your benefits have run out and you can't get back into therapy, it is kind of like a DIY. It really is just an exercise vault, but for every movement, I probably have, you know, on average, off the top of my head, 3 or 4 progressions on how to get to that movement, as well as modifications for every exercise. If you don't have grip, if you need to use a cane, things like that. Very specific to neurologic injuries. So hopefully you will head over to the website. The link is in the description below and check out that program. And then that is it for this video. I enjoyed spending time with you all today, and I will see you in the next video.